Thank you, Professor Radu. It's my pleasure to be here with you today to shed light on the experience of UAE, especially in terms of setting up the education strategy for the K through 12 system, and also shedding light on the e-learning programs and strategy that we have in UAE. So the title of the presentation will be United Arab Emirates Strategy and Achievement in E-Education. Now, always every country has a vision. This country has established in December 2nd, 1971, and we have all grown with our country, and we've grown with our leader. This person came, the late founder of UAE, Zayed bin Sultan Nahyan. He came from the desert, but he had a mission to invest in the people. And we felt that very clearly as we grow in school. At that time, I was about very young, 3-4 years. But then we felt it very strongly how sincere he is about the people, how he's sincere about education. And that's what inspired us most to go into the education sector and participate in the development of our country. Just a glance at the K through 12 system in UAE, we have about 1,190 schools in public and private schools. It caters about around less than 800,000 students. 61% of the schools are public, and 39% of the schools are private. Now, the country, again, is a very open and modern country, so it is very easy for private operators to come and operate in the country as private school owners. The number of the students in the private sector, it's 60% of the total students, so the number of students actually is much more in private than in public. And that for us as public sector is a very much a concern because we have a lot of issues to address. One of the things also, as I mentioned, the country is very open to different ideas and different philosophies in education. We offer 17 different educational curriculum. Of course, we mentioned we are the legislative body. So we have the American system, the IB system, the British system, the Filipino system, the Indian system. So you name it, you will find it in the country. That's why for any expat moving to UAE, he doesn't have that much of a problem to settle down and find a good education system for his or her kids. The vision is simple but to the point. We want to produce a student that are productive in life, but in an ever-changing world. As the speakers rightly said yesterday, this is an evolving place. Things are changing in the world. We don't know where, what jobs they're going to work in. Or actually, we don't know where our kids are going to work. In their country, somewhere abroad, no one knows. Highlights on the 2010-2020 strategy. The good thing about the UAE is that the cabinet has set the goal for 10 years. Even if the minister changed, no one can come and change the strategy. So that's a very good thing that happened in UAE. And I'm very proud that I've been a major participant to setting up this strategy. Strategy comes on 5 major pillars, student outcomes being number one. In the school and the student outcome, we focus on the curriculum and the teacher themselves. So everything that has to do with the teacher, it comes with the student outcome because they are the most attached layer to the student. The student school life, we want to make sure the student retention is very high. So the student environment and the counseling is very good. Student equality in terms of standard financing, in terms of exams, assessment process is done fairly and across the different Emirates. Quality of school performance, we have accreditation system that we have developed, and I think it's been in the third year, and I think we are doing good, but there is a lot to learn from. There is one thing that I want to mention, and Professor Dimitri mentioned yesterday, is that you need to be critical of your own system. One of the things that we find very challenging in the performance system is being transparent. The school don't like to tell them very clearly in public, on the website, that the school is poor, especially some of the big influential owners. They don't want to be told that their schools are poor in performance. Everybody wants to be outstanding, but that's not fair. If you put everybody outstanding, then you didn't achieve your goal. A student citizen, at the end, we want to produce students who can contribute to their society and to the global world while preserving their own national identity. And across all the government sector, all the different ministries, they are expected to keep a certain competitiveness in terms of reaching targets when it has to do with budgets and operation effectiveness. UAE strategy, main highlights, offer education, learning opportunities to all students. But at the same time, as Professor Mikkel, if I pronounce his name correctly, he mentioned very clearly, it's very important to address different modern style and learning. So you need to have a differentiated learning. You need to address the different needs of the student. Some students are extremely high performant, some not, but you need all of them to have a productive life for the society. And they deserve the right to knowledge without being physically bounded and also time bounded. In my time, I used all my fingers to write stuff and to communicate. Kids now use a single finger to communicate. They use the thumb. Of course, I don't want to promote BlackBerry, but this is what they do. They serve the word with a single finger. Now in the future, it might be the voice, or it could be the eye that they're using to serve the word. So this is what we should be doing. We need to cater to their needs. We cannot say, no, you have to sit in the computer lab and do it like I've done. It's not going to work. You need to address their needs. The good thing also we have in the strategy is that we have targets for 2020. So we already have targets to mention by 2020 how much the student need to achieve in PISA exam, how much they need to achieve in TIMSS exam. And it's said very clearly nobody can change it because the Prime Minister had guaranteed it that nobody will change it. So that's a good thing. If by 2013 the minister cannot achieve it or the ministry, there are certain people will be fired. And we've already seen examples of people being fired in UAE. So even in teacher training hour, inclusion of the special ed into the education system, it is also, they have targets until 2020. Where do we stand in education overall? We are ranked number 23 according to the World Economic Forum. But frankly speaking, we are not happy on the high level. We think that this is just an indicator. We've got a long way to go before we can claim that we are a high quality education system. And we are second only to Qatar in the Middle East. Okay, why do we promote e-learning? We said we focused on that we need to provide learning for a different pace and at different moods for all the people. Again, as Professor Mikla mentioned yesterday, students are doing multitasking, but at the same time, they need instantaneous information, instantaneous feedback. You can't tell them, wait until tomorrow. They're going to get bored. And if you cannot address that, you're going to lose a learning opportunity. Professor Radu shared with us some of the leading and cutting-edge technologies yesterday. So without that, if in the policy making, if you cannot realize that, you're going to pay the price heavily as these guys graduate and they start to become frustrated. And we have to always remember that we're always going to be struggling with competing resource need. Yes, I need to provide furniture for the school, but there are certain things that are very important to trigger kids' interest. If we cannot trigger their interest, we have doomed to failure in the education system. So the e-learning paradigm, how do we gonna approach this? I'm having a challenge with this. So if we look at the full cycle, you got the teacher on one side, you got the student, the relation is always there, but only it's the medium that is changing. The medium used to be just a book, a simple way of delivery. Now the medium of exchange of information has changed. So the teacher, the policymaker, all the way to the minister, we need to rise to that level. So the teacher has changed from just an instructor to a facilitator to a collaborator. He and she needs to learn as they are passing the information to the kids. Because we are talking about new technologies coming up, new jobs showing up. So we cannot tell them what are the jobs, but we can give them the competencies, the attitudes, and the skills. And as Richard Riley said, most of the top demanding jobs in the United States or all over the world did not exist in 2004. Core content of e-learning technology. You cannot provide one without the other. You cannot say, I have excellent CivicCore software, but you don't have accessibility to the system, or you're not making the school privileged. You're just offering to one or two schools, and you let government official from other countries goes and visit those schools, say, I have a top class notch education system. You're only going to be fooling yourself. So you need to have a very reliable system, very good training system, availability in terms of acquisition, copyrights, end user. The teacher should really feel that, yes, the system has been made available for them, and they have received the training. Because if you keep dumping this, cascading down from top to bottom, it's never going to work. Accessibility. Without accessibility to all, we have not achieved our objective of learning to all. So the computers themselves, they're just gadgets. Use it, becomes obsolete after a while. But teachers not, as rightly said by Craig Barrett, the VP of Intel. Also, the teacher, not necessarily they would teach anymore. They used to be the instructor. They become the facilitator, and now they should be collaborators. So they need to provide the right environment for the kids by addressing the different needs of the kids. Addressing the different needs means that we need to trigger their interest. If we trigger one kid's interest, he can show some phenomenal results. And we might expect that this kid, in the beginning, he probably could do nothing in the school. E-learning is actually an enabler. It cannot replace the learning process itself. Everybody agrees with it. So we need to look at how we can provide rich context. You've got the kids going to the malls every day, opening TV. So if you offer them boring material in classroom and say, this is ICT, this is very nice, it's top technology, he's never going to use it. If he cannot play with it, like the kids, you know, the kids, if you have 1 or 2 year old, he keeps playing the video every now and then. Why? Because there is a certain learning going on every time he's putting the tape, and you keep saying, if you don't understand him, I'm so bored with watching this TV again and again, or the movie. But he's learning. It's the same thing with the kid. When we show outside, you see the planets moving. You need to be able to play with the planet. How it's happening? What will happen if I push the planet away from the orbit? This is where the learning is happening. This is why e-learning is an enabler here. Provide opportunities for authentic learning, because you can really apply the theories and the knowledge very clearly here. Again, appeals to multiple learning styles, provide students with their own unique path of discovery. Certain students like to focus on certain areas. So that's very important, that we provide ample time and environment for the student to do that. So what we are doing in terms of projects in e-education? Infrastructure project. Without a reliable system, you cannot move on. We've got public school, about 730 schools. We are still lacking behind. We've got only 80 schools connected. Somebody might say, how come a country like UAE has this problem? We have two strong telecommunication company, but they are for profit. So they are not ready, like in any other country, to say, we're going to offer you this for free as a telecommunication service, the infrastructure. So the government is slowly coming up with a system called Ankabut. Ankabut means the spider. So it's developing a system for free for all the schools. But they are now connecting the higher institution. Next phase is going to be the schools. We expect maybe within 4 years, 2015, we've got the schools connected to the system. But before that, we're going to be really struggling with the system. So we still got a far way to go until that happens, which 4 years is really a far way. As yesterday said by Professor Radu, that you got every year, every day actually, or during his presentation, 212,500 people got born in that same 45 minutes. If I'm going over the time, please stop me. And the education learning gateway, that's a very important, the portal. Many of the countries got the portal, but what are you gonna do with the portal? One of the things that we completed is connecting a school, student, and the parent. So at least we are offering them a medium to communicate. So that's a good thing. Learning content, we're very proud working with CivicCore. We have developed the largest inventory of 5,000 interactive learning objects that is now in Arabic, that's offered to our students. Very important aspect of it is the training of teachers. They are the medium where you're going to exchange them for, not the medium, sorry, they are the people, the environment that's going to help to support the student in transferring knowledge. So we got 350 teachers trained in 2009. Another 900 teachers are trained this year. So what's next step? We want to cover all the subjects with learning objects. So this is for us is a very ambitious project, but we got a long way to go. So if we look at some of the material, I am coming from an engineering background, so I would have loved to play this game when I was a kid. Yes, I have a software, and instead of going to the lab all the time, which is a very important thing, but still I have the option at my convenient time to go and open this, play with the map. Until today, I play with Google. I try to find some of my houses, friends of my house in the United States. So it is a good thing to have. So imagine what it does if you were really a kid at that time. So we have kids now on these, connected to these software. So this is a very good thing that we have. And keys to success, also mentioned by Professor Mikla yesterday. Adaptation. You need to have adaptation. You cannot just import. This is not an air conditioning or a light. Say, okay, buy it from another country and fix it here. You have to adapt it and localize it to your needs. Make sure that there is not even a single word that's written that is not good to your, not well viewed and received by your people. Building local capacity. And third is partnership. And this is the advice I have for companies. Mr. Flory mentioned very clearly that yes, the technology is highly advanced, but the people who own the technology, they need to work with the people in the ministry. I have to admit, people in the government, they are very slow. They don't like to take decision. They don't like to take decision, especially the guys on top. They don't want to take any decision. So you have to find a way to convince them to do it. And one of the ways is to show them, don't show them a very sophisticated technology, because you might do it for one project, then it is stopped. Try to build the capacity. If you help them build the capacity, they'll work with you. Sorry that I'm telling you inside stories. So step one, what we have done to do this quickly, localizing the learning object, the advanced e-learning object translated to Arabic by native teachers. We use teachers from the subject matters to translate the documents with the help of Arabic teachers. And also checked by two other committees. We've mapped them into our national curriculum. And again, these are the changes we had to go in the software. And the team was very patient with us from Civico to work with us on this regard. So we wanted to guarantee that, yes, there are no mistakes before passing the information to the teachers. Otherwise, you're going to get a lot of criticism on it. Delivery. So what we are doing, you need to have a customer-based search for it. So you need to search the data. You need to be able to search the information beside providing it, the learning object. Of course, you have to adapt it with the SCORM packaging for standardization. And then we want, on top of that, to develop web-based. So a student can access for at any time. They are at home, he remembered something, he wants to check it, he wants to share it with a friend or with a parent. He can do that. And then the support for both the porter and the e-learning gate. Training is very important, and you have to be very patient in it. And you have to make sure you are cascading it down to the teacher level, and they are very competent in using it, and also comfortable. So it's a very proven methodology. They need to be there with the partners, which it was in this case was Civico, and they need to provide the support both in Arabic and English. Dissemination of project, a very important step mentioned yesterday and today as well. You can't have a successful project without sharing it. Share it, but don't tell people this is the best way, this is the only way to do it. Tell them this is how I did it, and if you find it successful, go and use it again. So sharing it in major forums like this one, like one we have in UAE, is also very important. Here is the Prime Minister, a very dedicated person who goes to the point, he checks himself. This is a major, it's called the Gulf Supply and Gulf Education Supply Show, attended by over 2,500 people every year, and we have 250 companies participating in this. We've got competition for the student on robotics and on different activities as well, and attended by the GCC ministers year after year. So where do we want to go from here? We talked about the teachers. And one of the good things also Civico did, as I said, sometimes you are slow. So they come up with a contest for the teachers to see who can develop the best content for the student, because the teacher at the end, they have every one of them, they have a unique way of delivery. And then disseminating of project through various workshops, training teachers with the authoring tool. That's a very important concept, because that's where you empower and build the local capacity. You cannot just keep holding the technology, keep saying, use me all the time, and I'll send you the bill. But you have to work as a partner to work with the teachers. They feel that they are empowered. They will use this on a very long term, and it will be a genuine partnership. Next step, we have a vision of being the leader in the Gulf in terms of the education, the advanced learning objects. So first thing, we want to convert it to iPad, so because we feel that the students are more into iPad. So everybody's bringing iPad, kids are using iPad, so then one of the things to convert into iPad. And then apply some of what we saw here, the technologies, the augmented learning and the 3D learning, because students, many times, they want to feel that they are inside the event. They want to feel themselves within the moons, how it feels if they go on the orbit. So also, we are working on content development with multi-touch devices. We have already equipped 30 schools with tablet PCs. And I think the next move is to put them on mobile devices. Students are all using mobiles. And as we saw the slide yesterday, more people are going to be using mobile devices than others. Thank you very much.